I'm happy to continue off of all these like incredibly engaging discussions with this idea of authenticity and also factual authenticity. I think the objects that we think of as authentic sometimes are not the factual ones. So, the John F. Peto Studio Museum in Island Heights, New Jersey is very much an object-driven museum. We fortunately or unfortunately have many of the original objects of Peto along with photographs of the home and his trompe l'oeil paintings. This allows us to place a tray in the exact part of the table that his father sat at and he took the picture there, and it allows us to place still lifes back together in their original compositions. Picaric, Doing, and Carnes, in a 1999 article, break down the visitor experience into object, cognitive, introspective, and social experiences. Due to the object focus of the Peto Museum and of this presentation, I will further simplify these categories into aura, information, and story, respectively, omitting the social experience as those are focused on the time spent with family and friends and do not make up a large part of those satisfying experiences. Aura-based experiences are those in which the visitor is awestruck. They're appreciating beauty and enjoying, quote, the real thing. Information experiences are to do with learning, gaining understanding, and knowledge. Story refers to the level of connectedness. Does the visitor imagine themselves in another time or place? Do they recall other memories or feel connected to the space? Bageac and Company found in a survey directed at visitors of the National Museum of American History that satisfying experiences were 36% aura, 36% information, and 20% introspective. There's only 8% social, which is why I'm putting that to the side. Based on this, we can identify the successful museum visit as a combination of those three components. These quotes, pulled from subscribers of the Peto Museum, reinforce that breakdown. Authenticity and the original object we know to be popular drivers to the museum visit. Participants enjoy the rare, uncommon, beautiful, and real thing. Information, too, is an enjoyed and heavily expected part of the museum visit. 97% of Americans see museums as educational assets in their community. This means that this is not just a satisfying experience, but very much an expected one in a place that is found very trustworthy. In some studies, more than books and more than teachers, the History Museum is the most trusted source of information. Coming back to the objects, at our site, we have the amazing luck of being able to house some of our artists' works. John F. Peto painted in the trompe l'oeil style, which meant he worked with very everyday objects at his disposal and in a realistic style. We have those objects from those paintings. The objects, unfortunately, have been left uncared for many years. We only adopted the house as a museum 10 years ago. So for 120 years, objects were in the closet, left to this older home with a not very protected climate. Peto died in 1907, and between then and our adoption today, it was also used as a bed and breakfast and various things. So the objects have aged, and we can see this particularly in comparison with the paintings and prints that we have. A century has no doubt altered many of the tools that he's used, many of the objects he's looked at, and we can see this kind of clearly when we compare them to the paintings. Of course, paintings are not always very accurate. Here, there's a bit of a jauntier angle on the top of the candle. The curve is a little bit different, but you can still see that things have changed. We, of course, don't have a painting for every object, so we have his original paintbrushes, but they too were left, and I'm not entirely sure if they are an accurate representation of what it was like to paint in the 1890s. The handles may be very different, and of course, the bristles may have been more tapered or less. So now we continue beyond the authentic object, because of course, a museum has many, many objects to display. I have placed here those components of the successful visit alongside the category object that might most inform each component, or being most connected to the authentic object. Information in light of the possible treachery of the original old paintbrush might be best presented by a studied replica. If I can recreate the exact dimensions and colors and materials of an object that by that is now rotted and rusted. They perhaps can do a better job of helping us to understand what it was to use and interact with that item 100 years ago. Lastly, I have included still story, and with that, the acquired object, which come to us by being a museum, or by the house having history beyond the artist who lived there. In a way, those paintings we have collected to show in their possible birthplace are acquired. They were not hanging in the room originally as commissions that were sent out to make money. Those things, that stuff, that continues the story between 1907 and 2019, and it contributes to the visitors' feelings of connectedness, their perception of this site as an integral part of the continuing community. The story of his granddaughter running a bed and breakfast and inviting strangers into her home for years really resonates with a lot of our audience. They come in and frequently mention, oh, I met Joyce, she's a wonderful woman. This house did a lot for my Girl Scout troop. Oh, this thing, I remember when she got that, and she really hoped that the visitors would think it was like a really cute, nostalgic addition to the home. So we look now to possible paths. Paths that might help reconcile the needs for authenticity and accuracy within our object collections. The first option, moving into the information component of display, is to embrace replicas, which many sites have done, recreations and reconstructions. There are naturally risks and benefits to this move, particularly with the stigma against replicas that visitors and other sites might have. Visitors could feel misled, they could mistake the replica for the original and obviously not enjoy deception. There may also be human error, of course, and it may be beyond museum resources. And with the Peto Museum, we do not have many. We have one reconstruction that was gifted to us by an Eagle Scout extremely kindly, but beyond that, we've been unable to really look into the original color of a paintbrush. But the benefits of replicas and embracing these sorts of tools that we can have at our disposal are great. You can expand stories and fill in gaps. You can protect your fragile items, and really, without how precious a 100-year-old palette is, you can have much more interactive moments living in the space as if you actually are an 1820s artist sitting at the desk working with the easel. However, I did ask our subscribers what they thought about certain museum features, and reconstructions were not very liked. They were not seen as an important part of the museum visit. My phrasing in this question was an attempt to incorporate both what they thought was useful and what they thought was enjoyable. So while a tour could be very useful, sometimes people are not enjoying going on tours. They recognize that there's information to be had, but it's not their preferred method of learning in a museum. So reconstructions ranked pretty low. They did better than digital aids and display cases, but obviously not as well as the original artifacts. Those were by far the most important feature of the museum visit for our audience at least. So considering maybe visitors would feel too betrayed by a facsimile, we should look at an alternative route. The written interpretation, which also may be the easiest for a smaller museum to kind of get their hands on. So, visitors are mostly self-sufficient in that they prefer to be given the tools and let to roam free. This is a finding supported by the Smithsonian Institute in 2013, and although that study surveyed guests of the National Museum of Natural History, I found in my own survey and discussions with Peto visitors that there's very little contradiction to this finding. So within the risks of interpretation are the overbearing aspects of tours and digital aids. They may be overwhelming. They may take too long for certain hurried patrons or simply not cover the desired material or too much material. While a visitor may opt out of either of these options, labeling and display are less optional. When we put those in, we are kind of, every visitor kind of has to deal with them there. So the risks of these labels and display cases, they could very much take objects out of context. They could also take us out of the illusion entirely. We are almost too aware that we are still in 2019 and that we are in a constructed space. If presenting a room as the artist left it is the museum's goal, as it is at the John F. Peto, then this risk is no small matter. Still, a presentation full of explanation, added images, and bonus information allows us to present beyond the limit of our objects within a reasonable budget and with easy alteration. But the Peto strategy, so far, has been to rely on our paintings and our prints of our paintings as representations of what things may have looked like at the time of painting. Of course, there is artistic license, there are aging varnishes, and there are many ways that these themselves could have several inaccuracies in representing what an object looked like at the original date. Still, simply speaking, allowing the preserved home to be more than a frozen space, to be a museum as it is, recognizing a passage of time and a dynamic history and story, is freeing. It saves us from the fixed narrative, the previous year's erasure, and the corruption and corrosion of time. I have presented a very physical problem and only two superficial replies, in all honesty. However, going beyond the questions of rust and patina, it is integral to our standing happily in the present day to not only accept that time has and will pass, but to acknowledge and respond to these continuing changes.